Hi guys, and welcome to this week's episode of the Talk Around Town Show.
Biosphere 2, a self-sufficient ecosystem right here in Arizona. This glass environmental research facility sits at 4,000 feet above sea level in the middle of the Sonoran Desert and is located in Oracle, Arizona, about half an hour outside Tucson.
Now it's quite toasty and warm, and you'll notice you can't feel it, but we can definitely feel it. We're in a rainforest.
It's very humid.
It smells amazing.
Yes.
Here's the caveat though, we're actually inside a building.
Biosphere 2 was originally meant to explore the web of interactions within life systems in a single structure with five areas based on biomes, and an agricultural area and human living and working space to study the interactions between humans, farming, and technology with the rest of nature. It also explored the use of closed biospheres in potential space colonization and allowed the study and manipulation of a biosphere without harming the Earth. There are currently six biomes, which are desert, marsh, ocean, rainforest, savanna, and thorn scrub. The first closed mission lasted from September 26, 1991 to September 26, 1993. The agricultural system produced 83% of the total diet, which included crops of bananas, papayas, sweet potatoes, and more. No toxic chemicals could be used since they would impact health.
Jump. Open, open, open.
Wow. And now the University of Arizona runs this as a research facility.
And does a fantastic job. These scientists are here doing really great works, you guys.
All sorts of experiments.
All sorts of experiments.
Yes.
We're gonna plant Courtney and see what grows.
Oh.
We are here at the ocean.
We are. I mean, imagine that. Southern Arizona, we've got our own beach, right?
That's fantastic. And guys, you can't smell it, but when you come and visit, which I expect you all will, as soon as you walk through the corridor, it smells like you're on a beach. So John, tell us more about just this location. I mean, what was it designed for?
Well, that's a great question. So we're actually inside Biosphere 2, so we're under the glass, inside the dome. And here on the beach, this is our ocean. So the tank itself is about 1 million gallons. And it was designed as a saltwater environment, just like the term ocean would mean, you think about it. So this is saltwater. It's pretty nice. It's about 80 degrees Fahrenheit. It was modeled after a Caribbean reef environment. So an area that you'd find down on the Yucatan Peninsula is what they originally modeled it after. So in this system here, originally there were fish and hard corals and soft corals and sea anemones and sea squirt, and there are algaes and there's different invertebrates in here. Today we still have a lot of that, but not all of it, so there are no longer any corals. But you know, some really exciting research initially came out of this ocean system.
Yeah.
So we hear a little bit about ocean acidification or these microplastics in the ocean. Well, a lot of that research has actually been done here at Biosphere. So we hear about CO2 in the atmosphere, and we hear
right.
that tied to global warming and other impacts, but just a simple change in CO2 in the atmosphere means that the water in the ocean is going to change as well, because it's
right.
a gas that's soluble. So what it does is CO2 in the water drives that pH down, creates it to be more acidic. And what that means is things like coral can't grow as well.
Can't grow as well.
So a
small change in the environment, just a little bit one way or the other, really affects this ecosystem.
It does. And for the first time, that direct relationship was demonstrated and correlated here at Biosphere. And you think about it, so carbon dioxide in the atmosphere was about a 280 parts per million just prior to the Industrial Revolution.
Right.
So I started working here at Biosphere about 20 years ago, and the value that we used was about 365. Today, the value in the atmosphere is right around 400 parts per million. So you can see just in that
20-year time frame how it's leaped.
Yeah, and you know, in about 150 years how it's really
where
changed.
It's going to be.
And so it's really, you know, there are impacts on that. And that's what we're here at Biosphere to do. Biosphere is a great tool to try to understand how changes in our environment may influence those systems that we're very dependent on.
Definitely. Guys, we'll be right back as John takes us on a deeper tour of the Biosphere 2.
We're standing in the tropical section, the tropical orchard of the Biosphere 2.
And it is hot.
It's very hot, very humid.
It's a sweat lodge in here.
This is an actual tropical climate. It's an authentic tropical climate. They have a fig tree, they've got bananas growing, and this was the primary sweet spot where the Biospherians, the original ate
sweet foods from.
Exactly, they would grow their sweet foods.
It's such a fantastic environment. As you're in here and it's hot, it's humid, it's muggy, and then as you step out,
let's go take a look at a more calming, cooler environment. So now,
literally 3 feet
from there to here,
and the temperature has changed exponentially.
It's about 70 degrees rather than 95. And here you can see this is almost what you would see in La Jolla or Del Mar in San Diego.
Something
San
just dripped area. On my face, Dan.
Yeah, that's rain. It rains in here. It's got its own tropical climate.
So this is the rainforest.
Between two plantings, when that first group of people were sealed inside, and in between that first group and that second group, that total number of plants that they ultimately ended up putting in here and stocking in the system was over 400 species.
Wow.
Now today, we have about 98 species. And everybody sort of takes a step back, gasps, and says, well, that's a lot.
That's a huge loss, yeah.
And it is, but the notion is that we still have a very diverse community. And a lot of that loss, those species were lost in those very early years. And in these out years, we get almost no loss year to year.
So it's kind of balanced out.
It's balanced, it's stabilized, and that's why it's perfect for research. Because now what you can do is you can say, okay, some people say the rainforests are going to get drier and they're going to get warmer. Well, what can you do in here? You can crank up the temperature, you can turn off the water, and you can look at how the system
responds. See what happens.
And it's not just looking at one plant. You're looking at the entire system.
Is it just left to grow? I mean, I know the research is done and what have you, but do you guys come in here and prune and things like that?
We do have to prune. We've got a few vine species in here that are not desired. So
like this thing that's touching my head right now.
Some of these guys here. We've got a common vine that many people have heard about is Morning Glory. We have another vine we call Cistus vine, and these guys. Are pretty invasive. They will choke out some of our upper canopy plants, so we have to come in and do a little bit of removal of them from time to time. But for the most part, the material that you see on the ground, if we need to trim some of these trees, like what you see here, we just allow that to decompose naturally and go back into the soil. And
because it does have an effect on the soil.
Yes, okay. The key thing is that Biosphere, think of this, is isolated from the desert soil here in southern Arizona by a 500-ton stainless steel liner. So think of it, there's a big bathtub that's underneath Biosphere. Then the soil and the concrete was put on top of that. So there is no interaction with the outside soil. So what you've got is a system that's interacting, but not having to be influenced by that which
by the outside world.
That's right.
So it's like a huge plant pot.
It is a big plant pot.
In a very simplistic way.
Simplistically,
it's a giant plant pot. It's some, they just, we're gonna stick this here.
But we can do in this plant pot, because it's big, and we've got, very nearly 100 species. They've been in place for a little over 25 years. So now you've got a lot of confidence that the results that you're seeing are true what the system is
are
doing,
true to
not
what
because the system
is
changing because you just planted them.
Right.
But it's been here for almost 25 years. Every visitor who comes into Biosphere to take a tour has an opportunity to take a look at the rainforest.
And I
see the ocean.
I love the idea that we've got, you know, schools and just everyday people can just come in and see it. The idea of inspiring young minds.
Well, and that's Biosphere is extremely inspirational, and it's a great place. So we can read about all the biology we want in a textbook. We can read about physics or the engineering aspects of things in a textbook. But there's nothing like seeing it firsthand, and there's nothing like having a young K-12 student experience Biosphere 2 to really get them excited about science, about engineering, about technology.
Fantastic. Well, let's keep pressing forward.
Funded by the taxpayers.
Right.
All of our funding comes privately and through, you know, people coming through and paying admissions. We also have a small conference center here on site. So, you know, the research that we do is critical and first and foremost in our mission, but, you know, the customer who comes through the door is vitally important for our survival and those who use the conference center. And so some of those folks over the years have asked if they could have, you know, a wedding here or something like that. So we don't do a lot of them, but we have done a few.
I've done a few
here, yeah, because we're a unique venue and people like to take advantage of it.
Yeah. Well.
Now, so we have the rainforest, we have the savanna, we have the ocean, we have the mangrove area, which we just walked by. We have
the mangrove.
So just like if you were on the Gulf Coast of Florida, you would find mangrove trees. Okay. This is a subtropical thorn scrub. And then on the far end, we have the desert. We have granite, schist, rhyolite, ground up, sterilized, put in these columns, and then what they've done is they've added water and they're looking at how quickly they weather. They've added water and bacteria to see how that changes that weathering dynamic, and then we've added water, bacteria, and plants to see how it changes. So this was a National Science Foundation funded project, and they just finished that up. Those blue barrels on the backside, they were actually used prior to putting the soil on LEO. So the LEO soil is about a meter deep, and it's a Landscape Evolution Observatory, and these were used initially to test some of the instrumentation that we were gonna put in there, and because LEO is a project that's gonna run at least 10 years.
Wow.
So when you put things in the soil, you're not gonna have an opportunity to go back and dig it out if it's not working.
It's gotta stay there, and you wanna make sure that it's gonna last.
Come hither.
None of this wind that we're feeling is actually natural at all. It's all generated by these gigantic turbines we're looking at, right?
It's all generated. It's none of it's natural.
So what are those generating like? Like what's the wind speed that, I mean, they're...
So when they're maximum open, they can do 50,000 cubic feet per minute.
Wow. 50,000 cubic feet per minute. So what are these white things for?
All of these tanks are used to hold water. And these, for example, when we rain in the rainforest or rain in the desert, some of that water comes out as subsoil drainage. So typically that's going to work its way down and move out, and you'd never see it on Earth unless it showed up in a stream or down in the aquifer. We obviously don't have that depth, but these tanks serve as that purpose. So all the water that would drain out of the rainforest soils or the desert soil would end up in this tank here. Some of these others are rain tanks.
Wilderness subsoil tank.
Yeah, this is a rain tank here, so if we need to rain in the rainforest or add water to the ocean, we'd pull it from here and do so. But this basement area, so you've got a little over 3 acres sort of in the footprint of Biosphere. You've got about 2 acres in a space that we call collectively the technosphere. We'll label our water isotopically, which then the researchers can pick up, so they can add it at a certain time and they can look at when does that show up in the system and where does it show up.
So you're marking the water.
We're marking the water. So the biosphere itself, the volume of the structure is approximately 7.2 million cubic feet, okay? As you saw, the vast majority of it's glass.
Right.
And having lived in Phoenix, each of you know how hot your car can get on a hot summer day, right?
Oh, God.
Yeah, so the energy comes in, absorbs into your surfaces, and when it re-radiates back out, it's not easily transmitted back out through the glass. And so, because it's changed its wavelength, so it's trapped, and so you build up heat. Well, the same thing would happen to biosphere if we didn't cool and have those air conditioning units. But even that, even us controlling the temperature, we're gonna have enough fluctuation from day to night that as you heat air, it expands, as you cool air, it contracts, okay? And if you didn't deal with that expansion and contraction, you could actually compromise the structure by over or under pressurizing it. So what they came up with is what they call a lung or a variable volume air chamber. So we're gonna walk down this tunnel. So again, just stay on the gray pathway as we walk down this tunnel, but this tunnel connects us from the desert to one of two geodesic domes that regulate air pressure for Biosphere 2.
Okay. What is this?
This is the lung. We're standing inside this large diaphragm. Okay, so what you've got is we've got a large aluminum dish here, a flexible rubber membrane. The combined weight is about 40,000 pounds.
So I don't know how I feel standing under that.
Well, here's the kicker. It's all held up as a result of differential air pressure. So there's no large crane, hoist.
It's air pressure that's holding this up.
It's holding it up. It is simply air pressure that's keeping 40,000 pounds suspended above our heads.
Wow.
So remember I mentioned that we have this large liner?
Yeah.
So this is that liner. There's just no concrete or dirt on top of it. So over time it's bowed. But again,
Wait. So there's 40,000 pounds above us, just kind of suspended and hanging there, and we're standing on something with no solid foundation?
Correct.
Okay, then.
These things, a lot of people say they look like landing gear. It's exactly what they
are. They do. I was going to ask what they were.
You can see where it rested at one time right there. So they will come all the way down and rest. This membrane, instead of being pushed outward, could actually
sink down.
Sink in, and we could walk up and touch it if it was in a sort of a non-pressurized state. And so what we're gonna do now is we're gonna walk over and open this door. And what you're gonna see is we're gonna depressurize the system. And this 40,000 pounds is gonna start to slowly come down.
Slowly, right?
Yeah, slowly.
Freak me out, John.
It's gonna start to come down.
Whoa.
Whoa.
See it? So if we just stand here a moment and watch, look at the legs relative to that black electrical line that runs around the perimeter or the links on these chains, you'll just start to see it.
Well, you can see the chains descending, and it's not even a, I mean, it's a slow descend, but it's enough to where you can visually see it. You don't need any special equipment to see this. This is happening.
You can see it right there. You can see how much it's already dropped. Okay,
sweet.
So as we walk out the door, be careful, because you're going to feel it pretty good.
Okay.
Please not enter. This is an active research facility.
Welcome back to Talk Around Town. For ages, scientists have been trying to learn more about the forces which shape the land we live on today. One of the most sought-after answers to the question constantly being asked is how climate change will alter water sources and plant life in a setting like Arizona. There has been no physical laboratory in which to test any related theories until now. The Landscape Evolution Observatory, more commonly referred to as LEO, is the new $7.5 million addition to the University of Arizona's Biosphere 2. LEO is a revolutionary tool for geologists, hydrologists, and ecologists. There are three individual slope trays, or watersheds, which have been built under half an acre of glass. Each one of these three slope trays is filled with soil about 1 meter or 3 feet deep. The soil in each slope is constantly monitored by hundreds of dense sensor arrays. The complex web of sensors installed all around the three LEO slopes measure many variables, everything from moisture to density to chemistry. The tubes attached throughout the slopes even allow for soil sampling and real-time testing. LEO is meant to be at least a 10-year-long project, so scientists needed a type of rock which will run through its natural processes fairly quickly. For this reason, volcanic rock was crushed into a very fine substance. The substance was then trucked in from near Flagstaff, Arizona, and installed in the three slope trays. Imagine this. Artificial rain from overhead sprinklers is released. This is water that the sensors will track through the soil and air, measuring evaporation, chemical changes, and erosion. Within 2 years after the crushed volcanic rock has weathered into soil, scientists will plant grasses and other desert plants to see how they affect water use and evaporation and how changes in temperature, carbon, and moisture affect them. Each of the three slopes, 100 feet long and 40 feet wide, is supported by a steel skeleton that was brought piece by piece into Biosphere 2 through a 10-foot wide opening. Loaded with ground basalt from a Flagstaff area mine, each slope weighs about 650 tons when fully loaded. They slope at a 10% grade, with gullies carved down the middle where streams might flow. A web of PVC pipes deliver water to 14 sprinkler arrays over each slope. The Biosphere 2 Landscape Evolution Observatory is undoubtedly a fantastic first step in addressing the fundamental grand challenges which face our society today. Over the next decade, researchers and scientists of many disciplines will answer the questions: how will Earth's landscapes change as the climate changes? How do water, energy, and carbon move through landscapes? How do biological systems like vegetation and microbes modify landscapes? To see the latest progress on all of the groundbreaking and exciting experiments taking place at Biosphere 2, please visit b2science.org.
Guys, we've seen the million gallon tank beach. We've seen the rainforest. We've seen the savanna. We've seen the desert. We've gone into
the tropics.
Yes.
We've gone into the bowels of the system and had 40,000 tons of air.
All in Arizona.
Who would have thought?
Imagine that.
And the lung, you can see the lung moving, and
yeah.
It's just,
yeah, it's like incredible. A lung.
I mean, this is like, this. If you've ever wanted to be an astronaut and live in space, this is the closest you will ever come. And you can literally be in just about every biome in the world that's
every
in existence.
Yeah.
Just within a couple feet.
Mm-hmm.
So, that's incredible.
Thanks so much for tuning in with us, guys. Please sign up for our newsletter for more little quick, quirky things that we do.
So thank you so much for joining us, and we'll see you next week.